One of the buzz phrases that's around the book, that I'm sure everybody's heard by now, is this notion of the big society. And I don't think anybody really knows, but I'd be quite honest actually, that nobody really knows quite what it means, particularly apart from David Cameron right now. I'm sure he'll tell us all in good time exactly what it means. But there's definitely an awful lot of fear around about what big society means from within local authorities, within community organisations, within the third sector generally, because the first thing that we're all very clear about is that it's part of, that either leads to or comes from an agenda around cuts. And that's the first thing that all community organisations, refugee community organisations, need to be aware of, that part of the big society is within an agenda of there will be less money available to run the services that you currently run. That said, I think it potentially, and I'm saying this with slightly great teeth maybe, it potentially provides some opportunities for refugee community organisations to get in there and have their voice heard, because I think it's such a shake-up, things will be different, the way services deliver will be different, the way services are engaged will be different, the way services are commissioned will be different, and it potentially offers an opportunity for well-organised, well-run, well-developed, high-level capacity refugee community organisations to get their foot in the door to really influence the decisions around what kind of services get commissioned, what kind of services get delivered in their areas. I say potentially, because there's an awful lot of unknown factors. But really, there's no point burying your heads in the sand. There's no point. It's not, it does impact. It will undoubtedly impact on particularly small to medium-sized community organisations that are currently receiving some level of funding or support from the local authority or their CDS. Because, to be honest, the figures are scary. We've just come out of a presentation there from NAFCA, where they showed us what the cuts in the coming year are going to be for each local authority across Greater Manchester. 7.2 million cuts in Manchester alone is going to have a massive effect on Manchester's ability to fund those kind of communities and those kind of organisations, because the reality is they're going to have to focus on much more core services. There will be some ring-fencing, and some of the nice but not necessarily considered to be sexy or not necessarily considered to be essential services will get cut, and that is going to mean less money for those organisations that we work with. But again, potentially, it creates an opportunity for those organisations to kick up a foot, to engage. It might be less about getting money, it might be more about working in tandem with the local authority, with the PCT, with the NHS, to talk about clever, sensible, new ways of delivering services that give value for money, both for taxpayer and for the communities that those organisations represent.
Just when it came in the news, when they talked about cuts, just the news itself was something that was scary, because some of us, for us to manage delivering the few services we are running so far, we depend on the donation, we depend on the funding that some may come from the government, some may come from a private sector or some other individual, but if there are those cuts, how are we going to even be able to deliver the services? Like, I'll give an example for the supplementary school which I'm running. I have about 27 children attending this supplementary school, and most of these children are asylum seekers, are refugees, and some are coming from families who are unemployed. They don't have any other means they get from benefits. So just the news itself was already enough to damage the morale. So when it comes now to practicalities, we find that it is difficult to just get these children. They want to come, but to get a transport, just come to attend the classes on Saturdays, it's a problem. Sometimes the mother cannot afford the transport for herself and for the child. She may only send maybe bigger ones that can come on their own because they don't have enough transport. And when it comes to volunteers themselves, some of them are also asylum seekers. Some have only vouchers which they cannot use for transport. Some are even just destitute, they don't have anything. But meantime, they have children. Meantime, these children need their education now. They cannot wait until the economy becomes better so that they can be educated. They need to be educated now so that they can be responsible and also independent. But if they lose from this point, of course, they will tell us, oh, the schools are there, they are attending school, so... But if already a child does not speak well English, the parents don't understand what is going on in his curriculum, how is the teacher going to support that child? So you find that some of the children are underachievers, not because they are incapable, but because they don't have the right support they need. So we believe the government should consider their position and also look at some communities and some... It is not just particular to Congolese. I know there are some communities as well, even British children that are born here. So you find that they are struggling as well. So the government should reconsider their position and see and look into it and look at the vulnerable groups of people and attend to their needs, because those needs are immediate. We don't need to wait until the economy becomes better.